And tonight, I want to speak to you about developing a grinding prayer life. Develop a grinding prayer life. If you are part of the grinding calendar, it's because you learned the secret of what grinding prayer is. That means not giving up, but staying committed, even though it's difficult. Even though there's problems, even though there's issues, you have committed to be all in with your attitude because you desire to see godly things take place. There are some things that we must not do. There are some things that we must not try to do. There are some things that must be conquered with persistence. There are some things that must be overtaken with an understanding that God is going to give us victory, not to remove the problems, but to overcome the problems. Sometimes the mountains that need to be moved, sometimes God's going to give us strength to get on the other side of the mountain. Doesn't it? Amen. So maybe the mountain in our life is not going to be removed, but God is going to give you the power, the authority to conquer that mountain that is before you, that wants to bring you down and discourage you. But we say, grinding along the line, I'm grinding, I'm going, we are simply saying that we have committed ourselves to do the things necessary to be able to see good things and advancement take place in life. That's why I encourage somebody and say, success comes from grinding and conquering, but we grind and conquer with the things of God. There cannot be advancement. And taking new territories in life without struggle and without fight. So let me write this out. Success is always guarded by opposition, but opposition is always conquered by persistence. When you persist, when you are committed, when you refuse to give up, good things take place. That's where we get the biblical concept of faithfulness. Being faithful to God, promise God to be faithful to us. And then, amen. From somebody, that little fellow is not going to help you out. He says, no, be persistent. Sometimes your attraction level will be the love that you have for God, and then you know she's not going to love her well. But that's not what it's about. I'm going to know that more of it is to be God. I don't even know if that's going to be fair enough. But the point that I'm saying is, the more you love God, the more attractive you are for people to love how you feel. Thank you. formula. That is how they came up with the name WD-40. You see, 39 times they failed before the fail, but they didn't stop every time. They kept going. Listen, we don't stop when we want prayer. We keep praying. We don't stop because we face one challenge. We keep going forward in the name of Jesus. Say, God, we're going to do things that nobody understands, but God understands. And he calls you a conqueror through Jesus Christ. How is the Lord celebrating right now? You've got to be one. You've got to keep moving forward. God is doing something great. Tonight I want to speak to you about the grind, developing the grind of prayer life. The grinding prayer life. Our passage comes to us by way of the book of Luke in chapter number 18. And there were at least three ways we must get our grind on in order to develop this winding prayer life. At least three strategies, ways for us to get the grind. And let me give you the background. Jesus is sharing a parable. And a parable is simply a short story to help us understand a biblical principle or concept that God is using to help us understand his word. And so he's sharing the principle with his followers about prayer and the confidence we should have in prayer and how we should not get discouraged and have discouragement override our faith. Reason the importance of prayer because he's expecting those that follow him to pray. Now, let me say something. When you are following Jesus, that means you are called a disciple. And if you are a disciple, we must do what we've been instructed and what we've been modeled to do by the person and the God that we are following. So, Jesus Christ. Jesus is a disciple of the importance of persistent, grinding prayer. I'm here to encourage you, our greatest weapon is not our weapon of our churches. The greatest weapon is not the weapon of our stage design. The weapon of our churches is not the team and the office. The weapon we have is communication with God, who is the creator of the universe. In your mouth, in your words, in your passion, there is power in life and death and the tongue. And when you call out to God, he responds. He moves mountains. He casts out demons. He heals blind eyes. He sets captives free. And he does it with the power of prayer. Pray. Doesn't mean to turn. Pray my life to get on it. Doesn't speak my life to get on it. Doesn't preach my life. Pray my life to get on it.
Come on.
Communicating with God is one of the most powerful things that we can do. Because when we are communicating with God, it is not a ritual. It is not lighting candles. It's not getting bones. It's not getting herbs. It's not holy focus. It is direct communication with the author of the future of our life. It is direct communication with God Almighty, Yahweh, Yeshua. It is not the way that we communicate with, but we don't have to use people that come to us. We have access to God by way of Jesus. Sacrifice that he's made. He teaches us. The book of Luke in chapter number 18. Let's read verse 1. God says this. Let's read verse 1 through 3. And he told them a parable to the effect that they ought to always to pray and not lose heart. That's another way of saying don't be discouraged. That's a way of saying don't be very discouraged. He said that in a certain city there was a judge who neither feared God nor respected man, and there was a widow in that city who kept coming. There was a widow who kept preach it, but I just want to say something. There's something about being and being persistent in your pursuits. There's something about even though things that are bad and wrong and disturbing, but you keep coming to church. You keep coming on Tuesdays. You keep coming. There's something about adopting an overcoming spirit when you don't stop your pursuit and you're coming after the Lord. There was a will. The Bible says that she kept coming. He says this, give me justice against my adversary. Give me justice. But the first thing that we learn by reading these verses on how we are going to align in our prayer life, we see number one, write this down, this is the first principle. We must possess a binding purpose. Possess a binding purpose. There must be a goal. There must be a reason. If we are going to grind, it's because there is a goal in mind. We are not just saying words. We are communicating with God, and we're communicating with God specifically. Some of us need to stop praying, God bless me. God bless me. How are you going to know that God blesses you? Be specific. We need to be specific with how we want God to bless us. The Bible says that there was a widow who went to an unjust judge, an unrighteous judge, and her request was, give me justice against my adversary. You see, she had a plea that was connected with purpose. When we pray, there must be a purpose behind our prayers. We were at a man up here this past week, and all the time. Later, the place where I'm trying to take it, adversaries, the adversaries are adversaries. We find out our conviction is our fight against people.
Yeah.
We've got to put a fight against people and turn to God. We've got to make sure that we have the right motives with our faith and our right motives with our pride, because if our problems are bigger than us, then we want to go to someone that is bigger than us, which is Jesus. That's why I encourage you. The adversary wasn't the issue here. The issue was that the judge was able to do for her what she cannot do for herself. And I'm here to encourage you to quickly go to the good Father. Quickly go to the righteous Father. Quickly go to the loving Father. He is able to do for us what we cannot do for ourselves. Our battle is not against each other. Our battle is not against one another. Our battle is against spiritual forces. 1 Thessalonians 5:15 says, "See that no one repays anyone evil for evil. Those seek to do good to one another and to everyone. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing." Pray without. Do you understand? Delighting in prayer is constantly praying. It's not just constantly praying, but having the attitude of prayer. Because we can't go through the entire day praying. I mean, we can't go through two places in the name of Jesus. I'll take it number one then. And I will rebuke it, go tell it in the name of Jesus. And then we can be a Oreo rotation with it. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about having an open heart throughout your entire day for the Holy Spirit to speak your life. Pray without ceasing, deciding the attitude that God is able to speak to us at any portion, at any time of the day. Really be praying for my mother's two boys, or sit in the bed by their granddaughter, and we're told to say their prayers, and there was a 6-year-old boy and an 8-year-old boy, and the 6-year-old boy began to pray out loud, saying, "God, I ask you for a new bicycle. Oh, God, I ask you that you give me the new Xbox. Oh, God," he began to pray out loud, straining on the top of his lungs. His 8-year-old blood said, "Why are you crying? Why are you screaming? God's not dead." Sometimes we pray with the wrong motives because we're looking for people to help us and people to respond for me. Verse number four says, "For a while he refused, speaking of the unjust ruler. But afterwards he said to himself, 'Though I neither fear God nor respect man, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will give her justice, so that she will not beat me down by her continually coming.'" Thank you. John, it delights God to see you delighted. It begins God's joy to see his children joyful. So the second aspect that we see here in these verses, write this down, the second point is, if you're going to possess a grinding prayer life, that means you're going to have a grinding persistence. Our prayers must be persistent prayers. Our prayers must have some tenacity. Our prayers must have some lockjaw commitment. Our prayers must be committed, not just with casualness, but with attack. Verse 4 says, for a while he refused. In other words, the judge was not interested in her situation or her plea for justice. But then she wore him down. She wore him down. She kept coming. She kept asking. She kept pursuing. And I tell you, that is a picture of our prayer life. Our prayer life should be one that we are continually praying. We're continually seeking. We're continually knocking. We're continuing to seek the face of God and the passions and the desires that he has for us. Something earlier today said, he didn't have the pinata. You keep beating that pinata because something good is in that pinata. Don't stop swinging. Don't stop beating the pinata. You're like, I'm the pinata. I'm the pinata. Because the judge was not paying attention. He was not paying attention to the widow. But he had to because she kept coming. Have you ever had somebody ignore you? Have you ever spoke to somebody on the phone, but you didn't tell they were preoccupied doing something else? You're like, I'm all over the place. I'm not. I've got a confession. I've done that to my wife, Lucy. And my wife, Lucy, and I are talking on the phone. And she gets to a point of frustration where she says, bring me my time to talk to me and only to me. Give me a call back. I'm like, oh, snap. Hey, because nobody enjoys being ignored. Nobody enjoys that. What's so interesting about our relationship is that when we were dating, we would talk hours on the phone. I mean, this was when we had to use call cards and actual phones. I mean, the actual handle. I mean, with the phone in the head, my ear would get raw from just having the phone. And we would reach points and places in our conversation where there was no talking, there was only breathing. You remember the other day when you're just like so tired. We just wanted to hear each other breathe. Oh, girl, you breathe good. I was like, if you didn't breathe, you'd be alive. The point that I'm trying to get at something like this. Your breathing was enough. Just being with her and hearing. I wonder if our prayer life, it's not so much about words, but it's about the relationship that we have for God, where we don't necessarily need words. We just have to spend time in the presence of God and know that we are in the Holy of Holies and know that we've reached His throne room and that He desires to spend time with you and me in His presence. In His presence. But if we're not careful, we're so used to getting used to what's always around us that we begin to lose the value, we begin to lose the specialness of what it is to be in an intimate relationship with someone or with God Almighty. We've got to be careful. As I get ready to close, your mind makes way for the divine. See, your faithfulness produces grace. When you grind, you are communicating that I'm not casually interested, I am committed. When we grind, when we keep coming, when we, the Bible says that the judge was bothered, you never bothered God with your continuous coming to Him. The lesson is this: don't stop. Don't stop seeking. Don't stop asking. Don't stop. Because God is working even though you can't see Him working. Even though you don't understand why the answer has not arrived and why change has not happened, don't stop.
I'm going to close the time. I'm going to say God is our son.
Thank you.